In this Layer for Sci video, we're going to look at a summary of Organochemistry 1 reactions so that you know what to work on going into Organochemistry 2 or as a review for your Organochemistry 1 final. We'll start with alkene reactions, where an alkene is a molecule that has a double bond between two carbon atoms. And in this reaction, we break the pi bond and add something across those two carbons. In catalytic hydrogenation, we react with H2 in the presence of a metal catalyst to break the pi bond and add hydrogen on both carbon atoms. This is a syn addition in that both hydrogens add to the same face of the former pi bond. The next set of reactions are called electrophilic addition, where the pi bond acts as the nucleophile, and the thing we're adding is an electrophile. The mechanisms follow a similar pattern, where the pi bond reaches for the electrophile, and then we add across the pi bond. Starting with hydrohalogenation, for example HCl, we break the pi bond and add the hydrogen to the less substituted carbon, chlorine or the other halogen to the more substituted carbon, following Markovnikov's rule. Given that we have a carbocation intermediate, look out for a potential hydride shift in this reaction. For halogenation, we add X2, for example Cl2, to give us a chlorine or a halogen on both carbons of the pi bond. This is an anti-addition, where the second halogen adds opposite the first, due to the halonium or bridged intermediate. Halohydrin formation looks like a halogenation, except that the reaction takes place in a polar protic solvent, for example water, so that we get one halogen and one OH adding to the molecule. The halogen adds less substituted and the hydroxide more substituted, following Markovnikov's rule, but they add opposite to each other for an anti-addition reaction. We have three types of hydration reactions: acid-catalyzed hydration, oxymercuration reduction, and hydroboration oxidation. Notice that I moved the pi bond over to account for a potential carbocation rearrangement. In acid-catalyzed hydration, we use acid in the presence of water to give us a carbocation intermediate. The alcohol winds up on the tertiary carbon due to the carbocation intermediate and hydride shift following Markovnikov's rule. For oxymercuration reduction, we have a mercury catalyst in the first step that acts as a carbocation babysitter, and therefore the hydroxide will add to the more substituted carbon without the potential for a carbocation rearrangement. This reaction follows anti-addition. In hydroboration oxidation, BH3 grabs onto the pi bond so that hydrogen goes to the more substituted carbon, and boron, ultimately replaced with a hydroxide, goes to the less substituted carbon. This reaction is anti-Markovnikov because OH is on the less substituted carbon, but hydroxide and hydrogen add to the same face of the pi bond, giving me a syn addition. The following alkene reactions are less common, but still worth knowing, starting with epoxidation. Epoxidation uses a peracid, which has an extra oxygen in what looks like a carboxylic acid. This adds across the pi bond so that oxygen grabs onto both carbon atoms, giving us a three-membered ring called an epoxide. Given that oxygen is holding both carbons at the same time, this is a syn addition. We have three reactions for dihydroxylation, where we're adding two hydroxy or OH groups across the pi bond. OSO4 will give us two OH groups that are syn to each other, as will KMnO4 in a cold dilute solution, but not in a hot concentrated solution. Going back to the epoxidation reaction, if we use a peracid, such as MCPBA, we'll get the epoxide. But if we follow it up with H3O+, that epoxide will break open to give us another hydroxy group, but this time as an anti-addition, where the hydroxy groups are opposite from each other. Oxidative cleavage is when we break not only the pi bond, but also the sigma bond, meaning we're breaking the carbon skeleton. And for this, we once again have three reactions. The trick for all of this is to simply cut your pi bond in half and add oxygens on either side. What else you add depends on the specific reaction. KMnO4 in a hot concentrated solution will give us maximum oxidation, where the secondary carbon gives us a ketone, but the primary carbon gives us a carboxylic acid. We have two types of ozonolysis reactions. The first under reductive conditions using O3 followed by DMS or CH32S. This may be the only one you've seen in class, where once again the secondary carbon will give us a ketone, but the primary carbon will give us an aldehyde rather than a carboxylic acid. But O3 in oxidative conditions using peroxide will give us a similar product to KMnO4, where secondary gives us a ketone and primary gives us another carboxylic acid. In cyclopropanation, we break the pi bond to form a three-membered ring with carbon, a cyclopropane. The first is the halo form with a carbene intermediate, where I react a halo form, such as CHCl3, in the presence of tert-butanol to get my three-membered ring with chlorine on that new carbon. In the Simmons-Smith reaction, we see a carbenoid, where CH2I2 and a zinc-copper catalyst gives us the cyclopropane. For an in-depth review on alkene reactions and mechanisms, visit my website layerforsci.com/alkene. Before we continue on to alkyne reactions, be sure to give this video a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and hit that bell notification icon so you don't miss out on any new videos. And with that, let's move on to alkyne reactions, which are very similar to alkene, but don't forget to account for that extra pi bond and understand how that influences the mechanisms and the products. You can learn more about these reactions on my website at layerforsci.com/alkyne. When it comes to alkyne reduction, we have three reactions. The first is similar to alkenes, where we react H2 in a metal catalyst for a full reduction, meaning we break all the pi bonds to give us an alkane. For the next reaction, we have a partial reduction called dissolving metal reduction, using non-ionic or radical sodium or lithium in liquid ammonia to give us a transalkene. But if we react the alkyne in H2 and a Lindlar's catalyst, we get another partial reduction for a cis-alkene. As with alkenes, we have multiple hydration reactions, where the difference is visible only in a terminal alkyne. For oxymercuration, I use a slightly different catalyst, HgSO4 and H2SO4, to break just one pi bond and get a Markovnikov or more substituted hydroxy. But since this intermediate is an unstable enol, it will automatically tautomerize, undergoing keto-enol tautomerization to give me a ketone. For hydroboration, I can use some version of boron, here I have dicyamyl borane, to once again break just one pi bond to get an OH group, this time added to the less substituted or anti-Markovnikov position, once again giving me an unstable enol that will tautomerize through keto-enol tautomerization, this time giving me a terminal carbonyl or an aldehyde. When adding halogens to an alkyne, the halogens will continue to add, and so you show the reagent in excess. For hydrohalogenation, we add excess HX, such as HBr, to break both pi bonds and have two bromines added at the more substituted or Markovnikov position. If we use X2 for halogenation, both pi bonds break, and now we add four halogens, two to each carbon that used to have a triple bond. Oxidative cleavage is a lot more exciting for alkynes, starting with ozonolysis, where we use the same trick. Slice it down the pi bonds and put an oxygen everywhere you split a pi bond. That means we add four oxygen atoms to give us two carboxylic acids for the internal alkyne, and carboxylic acid plus carbon dioxide if we have a terminal alkyne. If we react an alkyne with KMnO4, we have two options. If we react an alkyne with KMnO4 under mild conditions, H2O and neutral, we only break this pi bond to give us one alcohol on each carbon for each pi bond that we break. That means two alcohols for the first pi and two for the second, which is so unstable that it will react to give us a ketone in place of the two alcohols for a diketone product. If we react the alkyne with KMnO4 in a hot basic solution, we do the same thing as with ozonolysis, cut it right down the middle for carboxylic acids or carbon dioxide for a terminal carbon. Last, we have chain elongation. where if you react a terminal alkyne with NaNH2 in liquid ammonia, followed by an alkyl halide, the alkyne will add to the alkyl halide to give us a longer carbon chain. Phew, that was a lot. So on to radical reactions. Radical reactions will be covered in either Orgo 1 or Orgo 2, but we'll start with the basics that you're more likely to see in Orgo 1, and that is the three steps of a radical reaction. Initiation is when you have a molecule that undergoes homolytic cleavage, where the sigma bond breaks evenly so that each atom gets one electron, rather than heterolytic cleavage, where one atom gets two electrons and the other gets none. These lone electrons are your very unstable radicals. In step two, the most common step of a radical reaction is propagation, and that is where one radical will attack a non-radical to do a chain reaction, giving us a brand new radical. The last step, termination, is quite uncommon, and this is where two radicals will come together to form a bond, making the radicals disappear. To see this in detail, visit my website, layerforsci.com/radical. The two radical reactions you may have seen are radical reactions of alkanes and radical reactions of alkene. The first common radical reaction, where an alkane will react with a halogen in the presence of heat or light, where this is H nu for a wavelength of light, causing the halogen to turn into a radical attacking the alkane, giving us a haloalkane. And the second is radical halogenation of alkenes, where you react an alkene with HX, in this case HCl, in the presence of peroxides like ROOR. This breaks the pi bond on the alkene and gives us a similar product to the non-radical hydrohalogenation, except that the halogen now adds to the less substituted or anti-Markovnikov position. And now for the most exciting, most difficult, Orgo 1 reaction set, substitution and elimination reactions. Let's start with nucleophilic substitution, the SN1 reaction, that stands for substitution nucleophilic unimolecular. In this reaction, we replace the leaving group with a nucleophile in a unimolecular, meaning one step at a time, reaction. This is a very slow reaction with a carbocation intermediate, where the more substituted the carbocation, the faster, or should I say, less slow, the reaction. This is often a solvolysis reaction, where the solvent, in this case methanol, acts as the solution and as the nucleophile or the attacker, in this case giving us OCH3 in place of the leaving group. The rate of an SN1 reaction is equal to some constant K times the concentration of the alkyl group or the substrate. SN2 stands for substitution nucleophilic bimolecular, where once again, if we start with a reactant that has a leaving group, for example chlorine, and react it with a strong nucleophile in the presence of a polar aprotic solvent, the product will show the nucleophile having replaced the leaving group, where if we have a chiral starting molecule, the product, also chiral, will show an inversion of configuration. Since we're reacting with a strong negative nucleophile, this is a very fast reaction, and that means no carbocation. The stronger the attacker, the faster reaction, giving me a rate that is equal to K times the substrate, meaning the alkyl group, times the nucleophile. E1 stands for beta elimination unimolecular, and may look very similar to SN1 because the two reactions are always in competition with each other, except that in this reaction, we remove the leaving group and a nearby hydrogen or beta hydrogen to give us a pi bond between the alpha and beta carbon. You may see heat added to elimination reactions because heat favors the formation of a pi bond. In SN1, E1, you still have competition. This is more relevant in E2. This is a slow reaction with a carbocation intermediate, where the more substituted the carbocation, the faster, or once again, less slow, this reaction, where the reaction rate for E1 is equal to K times the substrate, meaning the alkyl group. If you have more than one beta hydrogen, you have potential to get two different products. Here we drew the major product, but we can also form a pi bond to the less substituted carbon, giving us the minor product, This follows Zaitsev's rule, which tells us that the more substituted the pi bond, the more stable it is and the more likely it is to form. E2 stands for beta elimination bimolecular, where once again we remove the leaving group and beta hydrogen to give us a pi bond, but this time it's bimolecular, meaning both molecules react at the same time for a fast reaction. E2 reactions require a strong base. In this case, we have a CH3O- dissolved in its own conjugate solvent, in this case CH3OH, a polar protic solvent, for a very fast reaction. Once again, no carbocation intermediate. You'll often see heat added to help stabilize the formation of a pi bond, favoring E2 over SN2. Once again, if you have multiple beta hydrogens, eliminating the more substituted beta hydrogen gives us the major product following Zaitsev's rule, and the less substituted beta hydrogen will give us the minor product. The one exception to this rule is if we have a big bulky base, such as tert butoxide, that is so big it can only reach the less substituted hydrogen to give us the non-Zaitsev or Hoffman product as the major product. For even more on substitution elimination, visit my website layerforsci.com/elimination, or for even more on all the Orga-1 reactions, mechanisms, cheat sheets, practice problems, and more, go to layerforsci.com/syllabus link below so that you can use my resources to follow along with your organic chemistry syllabus. If you're using this summary to pre-study for the upcoming semester, check out my organic chemistry pre-study guide at layerforsci.com/pre-study. The link again, layerforsci.com/pre-study.